My name is Pastor Scott Stewart. I'm very glad to be with you this morning, to worship with you, to share God's word with you, to give glory to our risen King, and to serve our Lord together. Before we have our opening song, there's an important announcement that needs to be made.
Hey, first thing, I want to thank you, Pastor Stewart, for being here and leading us in worship. It's an honor to have you here joining us today. Just a few announcements and updates I want to make. I want to talk about the call process, but in between or before that, I would like to talk about things that are going on at Zion. As we get going here in the COVID, as we're moving forward, I want to talk about the Orphan Grain Train. We have many members that are involved with the Orphan Grain Train and their initiative starting here in Houston. There's even a board meeting at a member's house this past week, and there's boots on the ground doing God's work through Zion's congregation. Also, our Z-Lert group, as we have the Hurricane Laura hit Louisiana, our Z-Lert group awaits the opportunity to go and serve the people of Louisiana and help them. But they're waiting on the power and the things they need to be of service there. So keep that in prayer as they wait that opportunity to serve our neighbors. With the voters meeting, we had an awesome turnout last Sunday. We had a unanimous vote to extend a call to Pastor Brady Blaisdell. And I just ask that you continue to bathe this process in prayer. Pastor Blaisdell has said that he looked forward to making his announcement of declining or accepting our call in the first week of October. So he said by October 5th, we should be able to plan on announcing to our congregation his decision. So pray for him and his family as they deliberate. Also pray for his congregation, St. Philip, there in Dublin, California. Lift them up in prayer, as well as our leadership here at Zion, especially Gene and Laura, our staff that are holding down the fort in the office. They're a great communication link. If you need something, need information, to call the office. They're doing a wonderful job. So continue to pray for them as they hold down the fort in between our calls. For the next month of September, we'll have guest pastors here, as Pastor Stewart is another Sunday, I believe, coming down the road. And we also will do that until we know the call, whether it's declined or whether it's accepted. So just continue to pray daily for Zion's call process, Pastor Blaisdell's family, and St. Philip Church. And what a blessing to be here, praise band leading us in worship. What a great day that our Lord has made. Amen.
Hosanna, praise is rising.
Rise up.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Lord God, you promise grace and every blessing to all who come before you and repent of their sins. Hear us now as we, your humble children, bring our prayers before you. Most merciful Father, we come before you and admit our sinfulness. In our thoughts, words, and actions, we have failed to do what your word demands. We have not honored you fully with our lives, nor have we loved one another as you have first loved us. In the name of our loving Savior, Jesus Christ, we ask for your forgiveness. Because our Savior humbled himself for our sake upon the cross, enable us in true humility to receive the remission you promised your repentant children. Amen. Blessed is the one whose transgression is forgiven, whose sin is covered. God the Father has taken your sins and laid them upon our humble Savior, Jesus Christ. Because of Christ's sacrifice, God does not count your sins against you. He has taken them away. He remembers them no more. He preserves and delivers you as his child forever. As a called and ordained servant of Christ and by his authority, I forgive you all of your sins in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Create in me a clean heart, O God. Cast me not away from your presence.
And take not your Holy Spirit from me.
Restore to me the joy of your salvation.
And hold me with the willing Spirit.
Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. Let us pray. O God, our gracious and loving Father, we are your dependent children. Although we in no way deserve your goodness, you freely offer your grace to all who turn to you.
Grant us faith to trust in your Son, who humbled himself for our salvation.
We pray this through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
May be seated for our readings.
The Old Testament reading is from Ezekiel 33, verses 7 through 9. So you, son of man, I have made a watchman for the house of Israel. Whenever you hear a word from my mouth, you shall give them warning from me. If I say to the wicked, O wicked one, you shall surely die, and you do not speak to warn the wicked to turn from his way, that wicked person shall die in his iniquity, but his blood I will require at your hand. But if you warn the wicked to turn from his way, and he does not turn from his way, that person shall die in his iniquity, but you will have delivered your soul. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. The epistle is from Romans 13, verses 1 through 10. Let every person be subject to the governing authorities, for there is no authority except from God, and those that exist have been instituted by God. Therefore, whoever resists the authorities resists what God has appointed, and those who resist will incur judgment. For rulers are not a terror to good conduct, but to bad. Would you have no fear of the one who is in authority? Then do what is good, and you will receive his approval. For he is God's servant for your good. But if you do wrong, be afraid, for he does not bear the sword in vain. For he is the servant of God, an avenger who carries out God's wrath on the wrongdoer. Therefore, one must be in subjection, not only to avoid God's wrath, but also for the sake of conscience. For because of you, also pay taxes for the authorities are ministers of God, attending to this very thing. Pay to all what is owed to them, taxes to whom taxes are owed, revenue to whom revenue is owed, respect to whom respect is owed, honor to whom honor is owed. Owe no one anything except to love each other, for the one who loves one another has fulfilled the law. For the commandments, you shall not commit adultery, you shall not murder, you shall not steal, you shall not covet, and any other commandment are summed up in this word: you shall love your neighbor as yourself. Love does no wrong to a neighbor. Therefore, love is the fulfilling of the law. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
I invite you to please rise out of respect for the words and deeds of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. The gospel for this Sunday is taken from the gospel according to St. Matthew, the 18th chapter. At that time, the disciples came to Jesus saying, "Who is the greatest in the kingdom of heaven?" And calling to him a child, Jesus put him in the midst of them and said, "Truly I say to you, unless you turn and become like children, you will never enter the kingdom of heaven. Whoever humbles himself like this child is the greatest in the kingdom of heaven. Whoever receives one such child in my name receives me. But whoever causes one of these little ones who believe in me to sin, it would be better for him to have a great millstone fastened around his neck and to be drowned in the depths of the sea. Woe to the world for temptations to sin. For it is necessary that temptations come, but woe to the one by whom the temptation comes. And if your hand or your foot causes you to sin, cut it off and throw it away. It is better for you to enter life crippled or lame than with two hands or two feet to be thrown into the eternal fire. And if your eye causes you to sin, tear it out and throw it away. It is better for you to enter life with one eye than with two eyes to be thrown into the hell of fire. See that you do not despise one of these little ones. For I tell you that in heaven their angels always see the face of my Father who is in heaven. What do you think? If a man has 100 sheep and one of them has gone astray, does he not leave the 99 on the mountains and go in search of the one that went astray? And if he finds it, truly I say to you, he rejoices over it more than over the 99 that never went astray. So it is not the will of my Father who is in heaven that one of these little ones should perish. If your brother sins against you, go and tell him his fault between you and him alone. If he listens to you, you have gained your brother. But if he does not listen, take one or two others along with you, that every charge may be established by the evidence of two or three witnesses. If he refuses to listen to them, tell it to the church. And if he refuses to listen even to the church, let him be to you as a Gentile and a tax collector. Truly, I say to you, whatever you bind on earth shall be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven. Again, I say to you, if two of you agree on anything on earth about anything they ask, it will be done for them by my Father in heaven. For where two or three are gathered in my name, there I am among them. This is the gospel of our Lord.
Praise to you, Lord.
May be seated for the sermon hymn.
Stone, I was covered in shame, made
Brothers and sisters in Christ, the text for our meditation this morning comes from the Old Testament lesson. It's short, so I'll read it again for you, just to keep it fresh in mind. So you, son of man, that's what God called Ezekiel, I have made a watchman for the house of Israel. Whenever you hear a word from my mouth, you shall give them warning from me. If I say to the wicked, O wicked one, you shall surely die, and you do not speak to warn the wicked to turn from his way, that wicked person will die in his iniquity, but his blood I will require at your hand. But if you warn the wicked to turn from his way, and he does not turn from his way, that person shall die in his iniquity, but you will have delivered your soul. The sermon is also related to the gospel lesson where Jesus talks about going to see your brother if he sinned against you, but I won't reread that. Brothers and sisters in Christ, maybe if you've been around long enough or even not that long, you may have discovered that sometimes there are some people in life that can be a little bit of a pain in the neck. Maybe it's our parents sometimes if you're younger, or even if you're my age. My sweet mom is not a pain in the neck. But anyway, there can be people like that, kind of a thorn in our side. And sometimes it can be just who they are. It's just the way they are, good or bad. And so we could either put up with them. Sometimes that's our choice, especially if they're at work or we work with them or they're a neighbor or something like that. Or we can try to avoid them as much as possible if they're like that. Sometimes, though, the fact that we think of them as a pain in the neck may not be a personality flaw on their part. Sometimes we may consider a person a pain in the neck because they tell us what we don't want to hear. And I know I have a person that lives with me, that's my wife, that sometimes plays that role. She's a wonderful person, but sometimes she can be a pain in the neck because she tells me things I don't want to hear. Sometimes it's kind of silly things, like she'll say, you know, you're not in college anymore, which that sounds like a strange thing to tell a person when you're 55 years old, but usually it's when I have a large ice cream sundae or whatever, you know, because that's the time in my life when I used to eat a lot. So anyway, that's just a little example. I don't want to hear things like that, or other things will come up in family life where she'll mention something that I didn't really want to hear, but I needed to hear it, and sometimes that's the case. We may consider somebody a pain in the neck because they tell us things we don't want to hear. I'm quite certain that people back at the time of Jesus and John the Baptist and the prophets and the apostles may have considered them a pain in the neck because they shared with them truths that they didn't always want to hear. In fact, Jesus and some of the others irritated them so much by telling them painful truth that they killed them. They took the ultimate solution. And now, having said that, Jesus calls us to be pains in the neck by confronting people in their sin, and even the flip side, to listen when somebody confronts us when we've done wrong. Because that truth, that painful truth, can bring us and them back to the Lord in repentance and faith. Now, most people, I don't know y'all personally, but I'm just going to kind of guess, at least 80 or 90% of the people in this room don't like the idea of being a pain in the neck. We don't want that. Now, there are some people, and sometimes I'm in this, who say, you know, there's some people who comfort the afflicted, and there's others who afflict the comfortable. And some people really enjoy that. And I know my wife sometimes falls into that category. She likes it. And of course, the comfortable that she's afflicting is, who do you think it is? Me. Yeah, especially when I'm reading the newspaper or something. So anyway, but yeah, we may not like that. We don't want to. While I may seem like I'm an outgoing person, I stand up here in front of people, and in other situations, you know, I may seem outgoing, but as my wife again would say, I don't like confrontation. I like everybody to be happy and have fun and have a good time and all that kind of stuff. And I don't like that kind of confrontation. I tend to avoid it. I also get called an ostrich. You know, you stick your head in whenever there's trouble. And that even plays itself out in my household. I have two teenage boys, 14 years old. And you can imagine sometimes there's a conflict in the household. And so, yeah, it's not easy to do that. But, you know, sometimes we have to. Sometimes we need to irritate a person with the truth that they need to hear for their life and for their salvation. Sometimes people need to hear that, and sometimes I need to hear that. Both the Ezekiel passage and the gospel lesson shows that God gives us a responsibility for others, just like he made Ezekiel our watchman. As Jesus said, you know, if your brother sins against you, he's given us that responsibility. Responsibility for those in the household of God, the people here that you know in this congregation or other Christians you know, and also responsible for other people in our lives who may not even know him yet. We have that responsibility. He calls us to be watchmen, to be messengers, ambassadors, even thorns in the side and pains in the neck. And along with that responsibility comes accountability. God said that to Ezekiel. You need to warn this person. If you don't, you are accountable if they are lost. And so we are accountable for the people that we have responsibility for. You are accountable for the people of this congregation, you know, if they are going astray. And you may say, well, that's the pastor's job, or that's the elder's job. And that's true. It is their job. But even those who are not pastors or elders still have a responsibility. You know, we have to kind of let that sink in a little bit. We have responsibility for someone besides ourselves. Now, sometimes I don't even like to be responsible for my own kids. You know, I don't like to have to do that. But to have responsibility for somebody greater than that is also something we may not be eager for, but we have that, our own brothers and sisters in Christ. Now, having said that, how we deal with that, how we handle that, you know, it kind of depends. Like in this congregation, you know, if, like, I'll just use a made-up example. If you know that Betty Sue, I was told there's nobody here named Betty Sue, so it's kind of safe here. While it applies to all the different sins and difficulties of life, and in the world that we live in, a lot of things are more acceptable than they used to be that don't really fit with God's word. So there's those examples too, but I'm going to use a church sin. If Betty Sue is gossiping about people, you know, and you know that, then you have a responsibility. A, first of all, to pray about it, you know, and B, to see if it's true. Now, if Betty Sue is standing right there and gossiping to you, then you don't really have to wonder all that much. And, you know, I don't really know Betty Sue all that well. Well, if she's talking to you, you can say, hey, you know, I appreciate that you're concerned about that person, but it's not right. You know, so we have that responsibility to confront people if we have a relationship with them. Or if, you know, perhaps if you know of something, you talk with the pastor or the elders to say, hey, I heard about this and I'm concerned. You pray for the person. One thing you don't do is you don't go tell other people. You know, because that's, I have to admit, you know, it's a thing about human nature, and I'm bad about this too. I have a fascination with train wrecks. And by that, I don't mean the real kind, although I guess that could be fascinating too, sadly. But in people's lives, if you don't have to scan the internet very often, it pops up in the little sidebars or whatever, and you hear about all the bizarre things that happen in people's lives, and this celebrity's doing this, and it's part of you just like, ooh, that sounds interesting. And there's part of us that just kind of likes that kind of stuff and gravitates for it, and that's a part of myself that I'm not terribly proud of. But nevertheless, our focus is redemptive. And one of the difficulties I have in confronting people is I realize I'm not any better. I have my own failings. I have my own issues. So we never come to people as moral superiors. Never. You can't do that. For one thing, that makes it harder for that person to hear what words are already difficult if we come with them that way. So anyway, we have that responsibility. But as Christians, we learn that there's no always easy formulas or rules of thumb. How should I handle this situation? First of all, prayer. And then if you're not sure of how to handle, you hear something or know of something, then you speak to somebody in responsibility and seek their advice. So anyhow, the other side of the coin, and it's equally important, is when somebody comes to us and confronts us with our sin, our failure, our wrong, or especially in my case, our omission, things that we should have done and didn't do. If that's a lot of times what I get confronted with, again, by that special person in my life, and 99% of the time, she's right. And so when that happens, we listen to them. Yeah, it's almost the case. All the cases I can think of in my life where somebody had to confront me, whether it was for something small or not so small, it was hard. It was hard to hear. For one thing, I was kind of embarrassed that somebody had to come and say something to me about something I've done. But it's also a pride issue. I'm like, who are you? Like, you know, you're no better than I am. Anyway, but we listen to them and we own up to it. And that's the best thing to do. We make confession where it's appropriate. And if that's a person we've wronged personally, we ask them for forgiveness. And that's the case whether it comes from the pulpit, from hearing it in a sermon, whether it comes from elders of the congregation, right, especially right now for you all, or for other concerned members, family members, any other concerned person that brings something to us where we have done wrong. We don't consider them a pain in the neck, a goody-goody, somebody who's holier than thou, even if maybe they aren't doing such a great job in the way that they're coming across. Maybe they're not, but so what? If it's true and if we need to take it to heart, we listen. We thank them for their concern, and we even consider them to be a gift from God. Because whoever it is, and even whatever their motivation might be, it may not be totally pure, they are doing it for our own good. When somebody is bringing us a truth about ourselves, they are benefiting us. Now, God has never been one to sit on the sidelines and watch people spiral into death and destruction. It's not his way. He's not content to leave people in their sin and say, stinks to be you, too bad, you know, and just let them be. And that started even in the early days, Genesis chapter 3, with Adam and Eve, when they had done wrong. God came to them. He did not come to them with lightning bolts. It's like, what in the world did you do? You know, he just kind of said, hey, where are you guys? And he gave them a chance. He kind of had a soft approach to them as he brought them in. Of course, you know, then it all kind of came apart as they started blaming God and everything else. But he came to them, and they eventually repented. He did the same with Cain and Abel. You know, where's your brother? Of course, God knows where Abel is. He's laying in a ditch dead. But he said, rather than just kind of striking Cain down, he came to him and he confronted him. Unfortunately, in Cain's situation, he did not receive the words well, and it didn't go well for him. But nevertheless, that's God's whole pattern. He's been confronting them with their sin and covering that sin with his grace. One of the things that I've been doing with my two boys forever, it seems like, is we read the Bible every night. It's a chapter of the Bible every night. Back in the old days when they were kids, we had the Action Bible. It was like a comic book that they really enjoyed. But eventually we graduated to the real Bible, a chapter a night. And I don't know if you know, but it takes a long time to get through the Old Testament. We've been through the Bible a few times. Back in the early days, I skipped a lot of portions of it. But yeah, we go through it. But the process of it, the value of it, why I bring that up is you see the pattern. You see, and my boys would even say, wow, God's really patient. These people just keep screwing up. From chapter to chapter, you see that pattern. And yet God graciously keeps going back and keeps going back. That's his nature. That's the way he is. And so not only that, he sends his word into this world. In the old times, it was the prophets calling his people back to them. And even more so, he did the ultimate. He came into this world in the person of his son, Jesus Christ. And now Jesus did not come into this world just to shake his finger at people and tell them all the wrong. It's hard to even imagine what it was like being Jesus. You're perfect and you can just see everybody, even the 12 guys you got hanging out with you, just sin everywhere, all over the place. But that was not his way. That's not what he came for. He did not come into this world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. He came to call sinners to repentance and forgiveness. And again, reading through the Bible, it's interesting to see how Jesus dealt with people. Who did Jesus speak the most severely to? This is a little chance for your response. You know, who did he speak the most severely to? The tax collectors and sinners? Did he speak severely to them? No. You know, somebody said his disciples. Well, sometimes they needed some chastising. I think last week we heard Jesus called Peter Satan in the text. So that's definitely going deep right there. But mostly it was the Pharisees and the chief priests, the people who thought they were the moral superiors, and they were always looking down on everybody else and thought, I'm all right. I'm great. I'm awesome, as a matter of fact. And Jesus had to say to them, no, you're not. And of course, that's why they ended up killing him, because they didn't want to hear that. And so that's how Jesus was. To the tax collectors and sinners, he had words of grace, because they already knew where they stood. And when they brought the woman to him and found in sin, And that's the passage where he said that he without sin cast the first stone. He didn't have anything bad to say to her. He merely said to her, you know, go and sin no more, you know, because she already knew. So that's his way. And so Jesus showed that his whole purpose was to save and not destroy by pouring out his life on the cross, even for the very people who opposed him. Now, he could have fought against them. Do you think Jesus could have beaten them? Could he have beaten them in an arm wrestle or whatever the case may be? In whatever manner you want to say, yes, of course he could have beaten them. He could have overpowered them. He could have proven to them indisputably that they were wrong. He could have, while he was on the cross, he could have just pulled those nails out and walked. That's what they told him to do. Come on down and we'll believe you. But that's not what he was here for. He came to save, not to force things in people's face. And so that's written all over the dealings that he had with people. And that's written large over the call of Ezekiel. Why did God send Ezekiel to say? Not to just say, you're doing wrong, but because he wanted to redeem. He wanted to save. And so also in the case that Jesus gave, you know, if your brother sins against you, it's not to rub his face into it or mock him or anything like that, but to bring him back, to redeem him. You will have him back as your brother. We are here today in this room, in this church, as a part of God's family because God took that initiative with us to confront us and to gain us back. Whether it was in the waters of our baptism, like when I was 2 months old and was baptized, whether it was through the Word of God in our life, if we came to know Jesus Christ later in our life, or it could have been both, if we were baptized and straight away and then God brought us back. Whatever the case may be, now, he's always still active in our life to weed out sin from us and draw us back to him. And I can tell you, brothers and sisters, in my day-to-day life, it's a constant process because I get off track sometimes, even in the same day, and God's there to convict me and to bring me back and to help me to follow him better each day. The Holy Spirit within us convicts our hearts when we stray, if you're paying attention to it, because he doesn't shout with a megaphone. It's a small voice in our head. When it comes to it and we're not listening to that small voice, God has other ways of speaking to us. And I know I've had those in my life. He can use other things to get our attention. I've heard it called, you know, the 2x4 to the head. Not literally, hopefully, but God brings things in our life to shake us up. And then again, reading through scripture, that's what he did back in the old days. The people wouldn't listen. So he said, fine, bring on the Assyrians to whack these people a little bit. And then they kind of, okay, God, we're sorry, we did wrong. And then they would repent. And then their kids would do the same thing over and over again. But nevertheless, God in difficult things in our life as a way of getting our attention. Now, careful word, that doesn't mean anything that is difficult in our life is something God's using to get our attention. God has many reasons for what happens in our lives, and it could be a way to draw us closer to him, whatever it is. You know, but God constantly, he doesn't just let us be. He always desires to keep pulling us back. You know, and so all those things, whether it's people, whether it's situations in life, are all truly gifts from God because he uses them for his good purpose of saving us. And it's another little painful truth that I've experienced in my life is that God is not that concerned about our comfort in this world. Again, sometimes God can be the person that afflicts the comfortable. He's concerned more about our relationship and our walk with him and our eternal life with him. And he's willing to shake us up a little bit now so that we enjoy eternity with him later. And so God has made us and uses us as his gifts to reach out to those who are straying and to bring them back. He has promised to always be with us in this sometimes difficult, sometimes thankless task. And I can tell you, as someone who has been involved in that, I've shared that it's not something I enjoy doing. I don't like conflict. I don't like confronting people or whatever. But I have to remember, this has a redemptive purpose. It's not to be a superior to anybody or holier thou or to scold them, but rather to say, hey, we're concerned and to bring somebody back. And so we have confidence because we're not on our own with our own smarts. Because, yeah, there's times like we have a little, you know, we have situations going on in our house. You know, we have, again, teenage boys. They got some issues going on. And my wife said, you need to talk with them. Dad said, you need to talk with that boy. And sometimes I kind of just go, because it's like, it's my own son. I know him well, but I don't always know what to say, how to approach this issue. But I'm not there with my own smarts. I know God is with me. And we have the power of God's word, which is powerful for tearing down the strongholds of pride, denial, excuses, and which can work faith, life, and forgiveness in a person's heart. We're not on it on our own. And also we have the confidence because we know that our purpose is a loving one. And boy, it had better be. That should be always the driving purpose, love. You know, we are told that we speak the truth in love. Sometimes people like to speak the truth to go a little bit. And I know sometimes I can be that way, but that's not right. And that's not going to help the person. We have that confidence because we have a loving purpose. And we're not busybodies. We're not cutting somebody down. We better definitely not be acting like a moral superior, but we're there to try to gain somebody back. So we have a call, a responsibility like Ezekiel to warn people of their sin and to point them to Jesus Christ. If somebody has wronged us personally, we are to forgive them in our own heart first, that's for sure, and we are to lovingly talk with them and seek restoration. And we should do that privately, person to person, and not talk about them to everybody else, maybe even not even to our own spouse, depending upon the situation. If we know somebody who has done something wrong, and here I'm speaking especially within the church, then we would pray about it. Is it my place to speak to them? Does somebody else need to do so? Whatever the case may be. But then, especially if they're not bothered by it and don't seem to be caring about it, we need to pray about it and see that somebody confronts them. Another specific thing I hadn't mentioned earlier, and this is very much a case in a lot of churches, especially Lutheran churches, sometimes it's not somebody that's doing something wrong, it's somebody who's not doing something, that is, they're not being a part of the body of Christ. Almost every congregation I've ever been familiar with has people. You may see their names on the membership rolls, you may even see their pictures in the directory or whatever, but Sunday after Sunday, maybe even year after year, they're not here. And so that also is a responsibility of ours to reach out to them, to help them to know. Because I've seen and heard some of them say, you know, I hadn't been to church for 2 years and never once did anybody even call or say anything. Now, again, it's their fault for not coming to church. I'm not exonerating them, but it's also the church's fault for not showing. Now, sometimes people make it hard, but that's okay. Because I know in my own personal situation where I work, there are a couple different people from my church that work there. This is downtown. This is, miles away from where we live. And I can see them when I walk around our campus. I see them, and one of them hadn't been coming for a while. And I would see her, and I'd go, why ain't you been going to church? But it's going, hey, how's it going? And I don't even usually have to say. I just kind of chit-chatting. I know, I haven't been to church in a while. And we'd talk, and it'd come out. But, sometimes in my heart, I would see her, and I'd almost want to avoid her. And it's like, why? Because I was embarrassed and I didn't want to have that confrontation or whatever. But I needed to show love and concern. And so hopefully, if we know about people like that, somebody somewhere in the church is doing that. So we do this because God calls us to. And he has first confronted and called us back to himself. We know God's purpose is to save people from sin and death, and to draw them back to himself. And we are called to be part of that purpose in this world. And while, again, it may not be always an easy thing to do, it is a blessed thing to do, to be involved in that. And I've known people who were grateful that process was done for them. And I pray that as God has given us people as gifts to confront us, bust us, love us, and speak to us his forgiveness, that we would be God's gifts and blessings to others, that they may be won back and encouraged in their Christian faith. Amen. Now may the peace of God that passes all understanding keep our hearts and minds as Christ Jesus our Lord, who has called us to be watchmen as people who reach out to others. Amen. Now, please rise. Having heard these words of the gospel, we confess our common faith together in the words of the Nicene Creed.
I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of his Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God. being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us men and for our salvation came down from heaven and was incarnate by the Holy Spirit of the Virgin Mary and was made man and was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried, and the third day he rose again according to the Scriptures and ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of the Father. And he will come again with glory to judge both the living and the dead, whose kingdom will have no end. And I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son together is worshipped and glorified, who spoke by the prophets. And I believe in one holy Christian and apostolic church. I acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins, and I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
I imagine we can just, I've heard we don't gather the offering right now, so we'll just remain standing for the prayer of the church. So let us pray for the whole people of God in Christ Jesus and for all people according to their needs. For all the children of God, the Holy Christian Church, that we proclaim the salvation of God wherever we are and to whomever we meet, let us pray to the Lord. Father, we depend on you as we share the good news. For the living out of our vocations, that no matter our station in life or what calling we have been given, that we faithfully represent our Savior with lives of humility and faith, let us pray to the Lord. Father, we depend on you as we serve you with our lives. For all children, that they would grow daily in the wisdom of the Lord, and we also lift up especially Paul and Jill Hagen on the birth of Britta Hagen, born on the 2nd of September. And for all parents and those who work to care for children, that they may be guided in their important service of love. And also we celebrate at this time with Vernon and Pat Schaefer as they observe their 30th wedding anniversary, and the flowers on the altar are dedicated for that. So also, let us pray to the Lord. Father, we depend on you. Live as your children. For all public servants who selflessly serve others, both those who serve locally and those in positions throughout the world, that they would entrust their lives into the protecting care of their Maker, let us pray to the Lord. Father, we depend on you for your protection. For all who suffer in heart, mind, and body, especially do we lift up Paula Casper, whose father had a stroke on September 1st, for Gina Landgraf's brother-in-law, who will be having eye surgery coming up, for Jean Goebel, who is having a test, for Juanita Mitchell, for Noah Harris, who is also having a test, for Lupe Alvarez, who is recuperating at home, for Annie Voss, who is doing poorly mentally after a fall and is now in a memory care facility, for Elaine Vircher's brother-in-law, brother Roger, and their sister-in-law, for Earl Meyer's sister and brother-in-law, and for Gary Wofford, who's having a test. We pray that they, with patience and faith, receive the healing care you offer. Let us pray to the Lord. Father, we depend on you for your healing touch. For these concerns and for every unspoken prayer that is on our hearts and minds, that our gracious Savior God would hear and answer us, let us pray to the Lord. Father, we depend on you for everything. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Blessed are you, Lord of heaven and earth, for you have had mercy on those whom you created and sent your only begotten Son into our flesh to bear our sin and be our Savior. Gathered in the name and the remembrance of Jesus, we ask you, O Lord, to forgive, renew, and lead us by your Holy Spirit. Give us humility and faith to receive the remission of our sins freely offered to us in his body and blood. With dependence upon you and gratitude in our hearts, we praise you, O Father, with the Son and Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me." In the same way also, he took the cup after supper, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink of it, all of you. This cup is the New Testament in my blood, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." As often as we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Come, Lord Jesus. O Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of the Father, in giving us your body and blood to eat and to drink, you lead us to remember and confess your holy cross and passion, your blessed death, your rest in the tomb, your resurrection from the dead, your ascension into heaven, and your coming for the final judgment. So remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Let us pray. O God and Father, we thank you for the forgiveness and renewal of life you have given us in the precious body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. Because we depend on you for everything, grant us your Holy Spirit that we may be sent forth to declare the wonders of our Savior to the world he died to save. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. It is good to give thanks to the Lord.
To sing praises to your name, O Most High.
To declare your steadfast love in the morning.
And your faithfulness by night.
The Most High God now sends you out to praise his name and declare his love wherever you go. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with his favor and give you his peace.
Amen.